thank you for being here. I'm a bit overwhelmed that this many women would have come out on a Friday night to talk about a topic that it's a little bit edgy right now. And so thank you very much for being here. So a few years ago, after I had spoken on biblical womanhood, that a college woman asked me the question, how can I possibly think biblically about my womanhood when I'm constantly being told that independence is power, that I am to determine my own destiny and pursue my own dreams? And she was very troubled as she asked that question. And I thought for a minute and I said, I know my answer is going to sound simplistic, but it's biblical. I reminded her of Titus 2, that God says that older women are to train younger women. And I challenged her to go to the women's ministry in her church and to ask godly women to speak the truth of womanhood into her life as a counterpoint for what she was hearing. But it was an unnerving moment for me because I wondered, is the church that she will go back to equipping women for this high calling of telling the next generation what God says about womanhood? But a second reason it was unnerving to me is that I wondered, how did one of our covenant daughters get to college and not know how to think biblically about her womanhood? Hers is not an irrelevant question. Gender distinctiveness is not a benign topic. There is not just indifference to gender distinctiveness today, there's hostility toward this topic. Even toy catalogs are making an attempt to neutralize gender. There's an aggressive effort to normalize things that God calls an abomination. It's no wonder that young woman was confused and desperate to understand and to know how to think biblically about being a woman. But we cannot answer her question with a simplistic, behavioral, formulaic kind of answer unless we put this topic solidly in the context of the gospel. We will distort it and we will come away with probably a moralistic or a legalistic approach to womanhood. We'll tend to be like the disciples who were on the road to Emmaus that we read about in Luke 24. After the crucifixion of Jesus, you remember that story. They were walking to Emmaus and Jesus approached them and they didn't recognize him. And the scriptures say that they looked sad. And Jesus asked them what they were talking about and they were shocked that he didn't know what had gone on. And so they began telling him and recounting all about the crucifixion. And then we read in verse 25, and this is on your handout, and from here on out, if you will, just follow along. And Jesus said, O foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken, was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted them in all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. He opened up the scriptures to them and showed them himself. And then he went on with them. When they began to eat, he disappeared from them. And then they said, did not our hearts burn within us while he talked to us on the road, while he opened to us the scriptures? And then they hurried back to Jerusalem to tell the others he's alive. You see, seeing Jesus in all of Scripture, seeing the redemption story in all of Scripture changed them from sad, slow hearts to hearts that were impassioned to go and to tell. We must put this topic in the context of the grand story, the big story. I love the way that the Larger Catechism puts this in answer to the question, how doth it appear that the Scriptures are the Word of God? We read that the scriptures manifest themselves to be the word of God by their majesty and purity. And then here's the part I love. By the consent of all the parts and the scope of the whole, which is to give all glory to God. Every part of scripture agrees with every part of scripture because it's all there to give us the scope of the whole, which is seeing Jesus, seeing the redemption story throughout scripture. If we disconnect any portion of scripture from the scope of the whole, we will come away with distortions. And a topic like womanhood is particularly susceptible to this. So we'll start with the scope, and we will narrow down, and we will see how all of that interacts in showing us the picture of womanhood. Ephesians 1 gives a stunning overview of the scope of the whole. I'm sure that you are familiar with that passage, and so I'm just going to show you sort of the outline of it, but I do hope that you will go back and read that passage later. In this doxology to the Trinity, we get a glimpse at what happened before the beginning. We get this wonderful look into eternity past. And in this passage, we see that the Father chose us in Christ before the creation. And the reason? For the praise of His glorious grace. And then we see that Christ redeemed us through His blood that we might be to the praise of His glory. And then the Holy Spirit seals, applies, and guarantees our redemption. And again, we read the recurring phrase, to the praise of His glory. This is known as the covenant of redemption among the Trinity. What I want you to see here is that each member of the Trinity had a different function in the accomplishment of our salvation. So a different function, but the same purpose, the display of the glory of God. Hold on to that concept. Moving on, we read this quote from Dr. Horton. God's very existence is covenantal. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit live in unceasing devotion to each other, reaching outward beyond the Godhead to create a community of creatures, serving as a giant analogy of the Godhead's relationship. Created in the image of the triune God, we are by nature outgoing, interdependent, relationship establishers, finding ourselves in the other and not just in ourselves. And then skip down to the last sentence. We were not just created and then given a covenant. We were created as covenant creatures, partners not in deity, to be sure, but in the drama that was about to unfold in history. And then the drama begins. In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. God said, let there be light, and there was light. And He named the light day. Notice, light did not dare disobey. God spoke, and light appeared. God's word is the authority. The fact that He named it is another indicator of His authority. He created it, and He named it. And then verse 26, God said, let us make man in our image, in our likeness. Being created in God's image means we were created to live in relationship with Him and to reflect certain of His communicable attributes, certain aspects of His glorious character. That's what it means to glorify God. So our authority is God's word, and our purpose is His glory. And then God created man in His own image, male and female. He created them. Our third foundational truth is that gender distinctiveness is God's plan. We were created equally in God's image, but we have different functions, but the same purpose. So here are three foundational truths. And they just kind of roll out for us. We're so familiar with this, but I want you to stop and think about what I just said. These three truths in today's culture are absolutely radical. And if you hold to those three truths, increasingly you are in the minority. And these were the truths that were being challenged in the life of that young woman who asked me, how can I think biblically about my womanhood? We've got to begin right here. And then let's move on. Genesis 1:28. God blessed them, and God said, be fruitful and multiply and fill the earth and subdue it and have dominion over the fish and the sea and the birds of the heaven and every living thing. Here's the cultural mandate. God put man in charge of his kingdom, and gender distinctiveness was needed for the task. Then we move on to begin to look at God's female design. Now, there are also principles here about God's male design, but that's not our topic. We're looking at his creation of the female. The Lord God said, it is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. We want to see four principles in this verse. The first is God's sovereignty. This was God's plan. This was his design. He sovereignly planned and designed it so. And then the second thing we see is his character, because it forces the question, why was it not good for the man to be alone? Now, notice he did not say the man was not good. It's the aloneness that was not good. Why? Because he was created in the image of the triune God, who lives in a perfect relationship, an interpersonal relationship of love. The covenantal nature, the relational nature of God demanded that his creature have one who was equal but different, so that there could be that reflection of the equality and the difference of the members of the Trinity. Now, in thinking about the Trinity, we have to ask, which of those three functions of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit is most important for our salvation? Well, it's a nonsensical question. We need it all. We need the work of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. But the distinctions are not blurred. The work of the Father didn't have to die on the cross in order to be as important as the Son, and so on. But yet, their functions are so perfectly complementary in order to accomplish our salvation. This gives us what is known today as the view of complementarianism. This is on your handout, which says, men and women are equal in being, but assign different, equally valuable functions in God's kingdom. By contrast, egalitarianism says, there is no legitimate difference of role and function between men and women in the home and church, at least not one that allows for male spiritual leadership. Now, that sounds very logical and enticing, particularly to those of us who for decades have heard that equality means sameness. But where in the world did that idea ever come from? If I held before you a red crayon and a green crayon, they are both crayons, they are equal, but they're designed to do two different things. But one's not a better crayon than the other. And so it is with us. But if we say this, if we say that there has to be sameness to be equality, we're denying the value of our creation design. But worse than that, we're diminishing our reflection of the triune God, and we're diminishing our ability to take dominion for his glory. There's a lot at stake here with gender distinctiveness, and it is one of the hot topics of today. And we must not be silent. We must know our stuff and be able to speak truth to the next generation. And then the third principle that we see in Genesis 2:18 is God's creation order. Creating the man first shows that God assigned him headship. This has nothing to do with status. Again, it has to do with function. Genesis 2:23, when the woman was brought to the man, the only word spoken by the man before the fall, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, because she was taken out of man. He named her woman, showing his headship, his authority. But he named her woman, showing their kinship, their equality, their oneness. He did not consider her or her role as inferior. Notice the quote from Dr. Wayne Grudem. The equality and differences between men and women reflect the equality and differences in the Trinity. Here we're talking about the nature of God himself. And he quotes 1 Corinthians 11. I want you to understand that the head of every man is Christ, the head of a wife is her husband, and the head of Christ is God. When did the idea of headship and submission begin? The idea of headship and submission never began. It has always existed in the eternal nature of God himself. And then skip on down to the next bold part. When we begin to dislike the very idea of authority and submission, not the distortions and abuses, but the idea, we're tampering with something very deep. We're beginning to dislike God himself. Now, don't forget, Jesus' submission was voluntary. He is equal with the Father, and yet he voluntarily assumed that position in order to accomplish the display of the glory of God by saving us. Now, let me give a couple of clarifications. Headship and submission refer to the home and to the church, not to the workplace. And a second clarification is, a woman is never to submit to sin. I won't elaborate on that, but there it is. Now, think about this. A man's godly headship shows Christ's love and protection for his church. A woman's biblical submission shows Christ's submission to the Father. So whether you're male or female, the function that you have been assigned is for the purpose of showing Jesus. And it doesn't get any better than that. That's what it's all about. The problem is when it becomes about us. The fourth principle that we see in Genesis 2:18 is God's design. The word that is translated helper in the Old Testament is primarily used to refer to God as our helper. So immediately we should be clued in that this is not an inferior assignment. And as I've just listed a few of the verses that speak of God as our helper, and in italics I have how he helps us. Just glance at that. He defends, he sees and cares for the suffering, he supports, protects, delivers from distress, rescues, comforts. Those are not wimpy words. They are strong, relational, nurturing, caring words. You've probably heard of the study that was done several years ago at UCLA. It seems that some female researchers who worked in a lab began to notice that men and the women in the lab responded differently to stress. And they learned that 90% of stress research had been done on men. And according to them, when the women in the lab were stressed, they came in, cleaned the lab, had coffee, and bonded. But when the men were stressed, they holed up somewhere on their own. And so these women began researching it. And what they found was that the prevailing research had said that there were two reactions to stress, the fight or the flight. But they found out that this had been done, 90% of it, on men. And what they learned was that women have a cascade of the hormone oxytocin that is released when we're under stress. And when those hormones are released, according to the report, it buffers the fight or flight response and encourages women to tend children and gather with other women. And when she actually engages in this tending and befriending, Studies show that more oxytocin is released, which further counters stress. If you look at those helper words, it's all about tending and befriending. And God wired us to do what He created us to do. He even gave us the hormones. Isn't that cool? That is just so, so great. Now, woman was perfectly happy with the man being a man and with her being a woman until Satan inverted the creation order and he went to the woman. The real war on womanhood began right here. It is not political, it is theological. The man and the woman sinned. They lost their relationship with God. Thus, they lost their ability to do what they were designed to do. They lost their ability to reflect Him because they had turned away from Him. When God came and He asked the man, "Have you eaten of the tree which I commanded you?" The man said, "The woman you gave me gave it to me." Her protector became her accuser. Fallen man, in essence, called her guilty. And relationships were broken, their relationship with God and with one another. But the solution is the gospel. God did not end it all. He did not end the story. But rather He came and the man and the woman listened as God spoke to the serpent. And He said, "I will." Now let me just pause. Whenever you see those words, God saying, "I will," here is sovereign grace. Here is His sovereign initiative. And that's what we see here. "I will put enmity between you and the woman." They listened. They knew they were enslaved to Satan. And they heard God say, "I will liberate them." They cannot liberate themselves, but I will liberate them. But then He goes on. "And between your offspring and hers." Offspring. That means life and not death. "He will crush your head and you will strike his heel." The offspring who's coming will be victorious, will defeat the enemy of their souls. This is sovereign grace. Here is the covenant of grace. And embedded in it is that wonderful promise that is woven all the way through Scripture. "I will be your God. You will be my people by my sovereign grace. I will live among you." And Jesus is the seed of the woman who came and lived among us and won the victory. Now here's the question. What was Adam's response to the gospel message? Verse 20. Adam named his wife. Do you get it? Because of the gospel, he was restored to his manhood. He was restored to his function of headship. Manhood was redeemed. But what did he name her? He named her Eve because she would become the mother of all the living. Eve means life giver. Adam was celebrating the gospel. He was affirming his belief in the gospel by the name that he gave to his wife. And yes, this meant that the females could birth children, but it's so much more than that. That is the beautiful illustration of it. But the reality is every redeemed woman can be a life giver in every relationship, in every situation, in every season of life, because it's the life of Christ in us that then spills out of us. Here is womanhood redeemed. Now, at one point I started wondering, why did he not name her some form of Ezer? You know, I can think of different things he could have said and used that core word. And then it occurred to me. Ezer, helper, is what we do. But we're in a whole new realm now. In order for us to do what we were created to do, we have to have the life in us, this name points to the gospel. It points not to what we do, but what we're given so that we can do. This is all about the gospel. Never forget that. Our redemptive calling is all about the gospel. And this is the legacy that we have to give to the next generation. It's the message that we must be equipped to teach that college woman who asked, how can I think biblically about my womanhood? We have a glorious message to give to her. But the problem is, culture and our own sin will continually tempt us to be life takers rather than life givers. We're justified instantaneously, but sanctification is a lifelong process. Becoming a life giver is a lifelong process. This is all about Titus 2 ministry and all of that, which we will talk more about tomorrow. But look at the chart I've given you that contrasts the life giver and the life taker. The life giver words can be summarized by community and compassion. Woman has been designed to tend and to befriend, to nurture relationships, and to extend practical compassion. The life taker words bring division and destruction. A helper does not enable others to sin. A helper helps others to glorify God, and that takes great strength. It takes great faith. But now, what does this look like when it's fleshed out into life? We have a wonderful godly son-in-law that he's just my son. He is our son, and we love him so much. And he and our daughter have 4 children. Scott's work means that he has to travel, but we're not complaining. We're very thankful that he has a good job, you know. But a couple of years ago, when his travel had increased, 8-year-old Maggie one night started whining, "I miss my daddy. I miss my daddy. I want to call my daddy." And soon there were tears going down. And then 6-year-old Kate gets into the act. That's how it works with us females. And soon you have 2 wailing little girls. "We miss our daddy. We want to call our daddy." You know, on and on. And our daughter set them down. And she said, "Girls, your daddy has told you that you can call him anytime when he's away. But I'm not going to let you call him right now." And they just looked at her. She said, "If you call him now, you will make him very sad and you'll make him feel guilty. When you can call and encourage him, then I'll let you call him." And they thought a minute, and Maggie said, "I will wait until tomorrow." Timing is everything, girls, and sometimes we need to wait until tomorrow. Lauren called me the next morning, though, and she said, "Mom, did I do the right thing? Was that right to not let them call him?" And I, absolutely, you did the right thing. You're teaching them not to be manipulative, whining women who lay guilt trips on a husband who is out working so that you can be at home with those girls. And yes, you did the right thing. We want them to grow up to be life givers and not life takers. How does it apply to all of us? There are many, many ways we could make application as far as our corporate role as women in God's church. One leader of a women's ministry team told me that after they had learned all of this, that now, no matter what they're discussing, no matter what decisions they're making, what plans they're making, the bottom line is always, will this give life to our church? Or will it suck the life out of our church? Not just our women's ministry, but our church. It's a good question to ask. The life giver words are covenant words. They are a description of covenant life, of what God intends for his covenant family. And it's so interesting to me that as we go on with the story, in the very next chapter, God gives us the contrast of the way of Cain and the way of Christ. You know that familiar story. Cain killed his brother. God said, "Where is your brother?" And he said, I don't know, am I my brother's keeper? You see, the way of Cain is the way of independence. It's all about me. The way of Christ is the way of interdependence. We are our brothers and sisters' keeper. Now, let me quickly say, the government is not my keeper. The family of God is my keeper, and I am the keeper of the brothers and sisters in Christ in my local church where God has sent me to be a part. We are to love and care for one another. We're to disciple and encourage one another. We're to be there for one another. We're to look like a family because we are. And we're to live this gloriously interdependent life for the glory of God. We go on in that chapter and we see that Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod. Going away from the presence of the Lord means self-rule. The way of Cain is self-rule. The way of Christ is God's authority, God's rule. His word is our authority. You see, we're going right back to those foundational principles. And then Cain knew his wife. She conceived and bore a son. When he built a city, he called the name of the city after his son. Building our own cities is living for our own glory. The way of Christ is living for God's glory. Do you see what we're getting here in the very beginning chapters of Genesis? We're getting this peek at the church. We're seeing the contrast between the world, which says it's all about you, seek your own destiny, determine your own destiny, and the church that says we live for the glory of God under the authority of God, and we look like the children of God as we care for one another. This is so important that Jesus prayed for it in his high priestly prayer for us in John 17. The glory that you have given me, I've given to them that they may be one, even as we are one. I and them, you and me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and loved them even as you loved me. It's about the gospel. Our unity, our community, the communion of the saints, shows the world that God sent Jesus and that God loves us. It shows the gospel. In the system of Cain, the helper design makes absolutely no sense, and the world will never get it. In the way of Christ, not only is the helper design, does it make sense, does it fit, but it is essential for community life to be what God intended to be, a reflection of the very character of the triune God. You see how our womanhood is woven all through these opening chapters? We will never understand our womanhood or our place in God's church unless we see it through the lens of this historical, redemptive perspective. And we'll keep exploring that tonight as well as tomorrow. Now, as you move on in the Genesis narrative, you remember how that the promise, the covenant promise, is given to Abraham. And then Abraham still doesn't have children. We come to Genesis 15, and that's that wonderful chapter where God takes him out and shows him the stars and says, your offspring will be as numerous as the stars. And then God says something rather startling to him. He tells him that his offspring will be sojourners in a land that is not theirs, and they'll be servants, and they'll be afflicted for 400 years. But I will bring judgment on the nation, and I will bring you out. Now turn to Exodus 1 as I bring you up to that part of the story. Abraham's great-grandson Joseph was eventually sold into slavery into Egypt, and you remember how he became second in command. And he invited his father and his brothers to come there and live. And Genesis concludes. 400 years have passed, and we come to Exodus chapter 1. Verse 6. Now Joseph and all his brothers and all that generation died, but the Israelites were fruitful and multiplied greatly and became exceedingly numerous, so that the land was filled with them. A new king who did not know about Joseph came to power. Now he was worried about all these Israelites, and so he devised a wicked plan. Verse 15. The king of Egypt said to the Hebrew midwives, whose names were Shiphrah and Puah, "When you help the Hebrew women in childbirth and observe them on the delivery stool, if it is a boy, kill him. But if it is a girl, let her live." The Israelites faced annihilation. This meant that the covenant promise would be broken. Could there possibly still be any hope that the promise was true? It has been 400 years. Did anybody still know about that obscure promise to Abraham? And if they knew about it, did they believe in it? Think for a moment how far we have moved in less than 400 years from the founding principles of our country. Now, this had been 400 years they had been in Egypt. Did anybody remember that promise? Verse 17 just shines forth to us. The midwives feared God and did not do what the king of Egypt had told them to do. They let the boys live. To fear God means to submit to his rule as king because we trust him. And that's what they did. Hope was alive and well in the hearts of these women. There's no other explanation for their abandon in obeying God. This was an intelligent risk because they were hoping in the promise. And remember, it's doubtful that any baby that they would rescue would be of any benefit to them, because by the time that baby could grow up and lead them out of Israel, out of Egypt, they would probably be dead. These women thought and acted covenantally. They understood that they were their brothers and sisters' keeper. This was a pro-life ministry. They were willing to sacrifice for the common good and for future generations. And it seems to me that a culture of true womanhood emerged and flourished. We know that Jochebed devised a bold plan to save her baby. And her young daughter Miriam seemed to follow the lead of these heroines. Her courage just indicates that she hoped in the promise. These women believed the promise. Their authority was God's word, not the command of the Pharaoh. Their purpose was his glory. They tended and they befriended and they made a difference. They were used to extend God's kingdom. Probably never imagined the implications of what they did. Their obedience should challenge us. They were what the psalmist called pillars carved to adorn a palace. In Psalm 144, David is praying during a time of conflict. And in verse 12, he says, "Our sons in their youth will be like well-nurtured plants, and our daughters will be like pillars carved to adorn a palace." Notice he says, "our sons, our daughters." This is covenantal, not individualistic language. These are the sons and daughters of the church. Now, when I first read this and began thinking about it, our daughters would be like pillars, the first image that came to my mind was Lot's wife being turned into a pillar of salt. And I thought, oops, that's not good. You remember that story that God sent the angel to go and tell Lot to leave and to take his family. And he said, don't look back. But Lot's wife looked back and she became a pillar of salt. The word that is used there for pillar is a word that means stopped and trapped in a still, upright position. And Jesus gives us some sobering words. Just as it was in the days of Lot, they were eating and drinking, buying and selling, planting and building. But on the day when Lot went out from Sodom, fire and sulfur rained from heaven and destroyed them all. So will it be on the day when the Son of Man is revealed, remember Lot's wife. Whoever seeks to preserve his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life will keep it. You see, the one who gives of her life, who decreases that Jesus might increase, is a life giver. The one who holds on to her life is a life taker and brings destruction and division. The word that is translated pillar in Psalm 144 is a verse that refers to a functional, supportive, and often beautifully carved pillars. It would be pillars like this that support a building. And in many of the ancient buildings, they were carved in the shape of beautiful women. This kind of a pillar has brings stability and beauty to the home and to the church. Carving is a very tender and a tedious and a transforming process. And there are times when it's a painful process. You can imagine the block of stone at times saying, "Don't chisel so deep, it hurts. Don't sand right here anymore, it hurts." But you see, the sculptor sees something very beautiful, and he's chiseling away until that emerges. That's the picture that we have here. We have 12 grandchildren, such a wonderful group, from 23 down to 8. And we love, because there's so many of them, to take them in smaller groups and configurations of cousins on trips. And one of our favorite things is to take small groups of them to Washington to see all the historical sites. When we took the oldest four, it was the three older boys and our oldest granddaughter, and she was 16 at the time. We'd done all the different things, and then we went to the Capitol building, and we saw the, just, it's a wonderful, wonderful tour. But we saw the upstairs with that amazing rotunda. And then the guide took us down to the basement level. And we saw all the things down there. But then she showed us a big star at one spot on the floor. And she said, "This star is the very center of the Capitol building. And it's also the center of Washington, D.C. All streets are numbered out from here." And we lined up, and we could each go and put our foot right on that star. Well, after Mary Kate and I had had our time, I took her hand and pulled her back a ways. And I said, "Mary Kate, tell me what you see." "Well, you see, here's the star, but around it in two circles are 40 massive columns." And I said, "Tell me what you see." She said, "Our daughters will be like pillars carved to adorn a palace." And I said, "Mary Kate, you remember that magnificent rotunda? Here is the support system for it. If we had not come down here, you would never have seen this. But if these columns begin to weaken, that entire structure is in danger. But think about this too. It only takes 40 columns to support it." 40 is not many when you think about it. What a picture. This is the legacy that we have to give and that we must give. There's a lot at stake. Families, our churches, our very culture. And oh, that Christian women will come forth and be prepared to tell the next generation of God's glorious design of us as women and of his redemptive calling for us to be life givers. I really want to impress this upon all of our hearts with a visual picture. I'd like to ask all of our college, high school, middle school girls, if you'll just come up and let us, you are the visual aid of the next generation. Will you just come up and maybe line up right over here and bring your card, your red, they have red card? Your blue cards, if you'll bring your card with you. Our college, high school, middle school, younger, any girls that we have. Let's see if we can just get you all right over here. Oh, we can line up on both sides. It might be easier for you, just wherever you are. Oh, my goodness, look how many. Oh, this is wonderful. Oh, yay. Oh, girls. Do you know that today, can they hear me if I come out? The trends tell us. Now, can you girls hear me? The trends tell us that 80% of the youth who are in churches today, 80% will leave the church and never return. That is terrifying if we only trusted in trends. But we're praying for revival, and we're praying for a revival of womanhood, and we look at you and we're so hopeful. We see life givers, and you don't have to wait until you're 20 or 25. Right now, now is the time. And we want to tell you that we love you, and we're praying for you, and we're here to tell you the glories of what God has done, the glories of our God and King. Thank you. I want to ask some women to come up. Do you want to get the women to come up who are supposed to? You want me to pray for them first? I want to pray for you, and then we're going to have these women come up and just connect with you. Let's pray. Oh my goodness, I wish I could hug every one of you. Father in heaven, we just thank you so much that these young women would on a Friday night be here among Christian women to hear about Christian womanhood. Father, we praise you for each one of them. And I pray that you will rain out such blessings in their life, that your Holy Spirit will give them a great passion to live out your calling and your design. Give them, Lord, the courage to stand strong and pure in a culture that's telling them that it's all about them. Father, may they see the grand and glorious destiny that you have for us in molding and shaping and carving us so that we actually reflect the glory of who you are. And may they do that. As young women, may they increasingly become life givers for your glory and the advancement of your kingdom. In the name of Jesus, amen.